We're going to now talk about the applications of bear clinic fluids and our understanding of how they operate to talk about what goes on with a dry line and the vertical circulation associated with a dry line. And we're going to start up by talking about what's happening at night. At nighttime, you know, we have dry air to the west of the dry line, relatively more moist air to the east of a dry line. So to the west of the dry line, where we have that dry air, originally it came off the mountains, off the higher elevations, western plateau. That air, which is relatively drier, is going to be experiencing much greater outgoing long wave radiation than farther to the east of the dry line, where the moisture, where relatively moist air is present. And so over the areas west of the dry line, we're going to experience much greater cooling rates at nighttime. And so looking at the effects of temperature, it's going to be cooling off much more substantially than to the east. So the density is going to be much higher to the west of the dry line than to the east. So temperature is going to be dry, or the effects of temperature will be density that is going to be much higher to the west and lower to the east. Since at night, relatively more moist air to the east of the dry line is going to be associated with a lower cooling rate than to the west of the dry line. And so we're going to be dealing with what I'll describe here as cold night and somewhat warmer than to the west over areas that are more moist to the east of the dry line. And then also, as we talked about earlier, associated with moisture differences, we're dealing with drier conditions to the west of the dry line associated with higher density to the west of the dry line than to the east of the dry line, where as to the east of the dry line, it's relatively more moist. And density for moist air, remember, is going to be lower than associated with dry air. So we have consistent lower density from the effects of temperature and moisture to the east of the dry line than to the west of the dry line, where we have relatively higher density associated with both colder air and drier air. And so as a result, at nighttime, we're going to be dealing with lower density air to the east of the dry line. And that is going to be associated with vertical circulation supporting lift or ascent on the moist side of the dry line and subsidence on the for the higher density air on the west of the dry line. But because it's capped at night to the east of the dry line, the fact that we do get this vertical circulation, it's not going to be particularly meaningful in most circumstances owing to the presence of nocturnal capping, particularly with relatively warmer conditions aloft. Higher potential temperature aloft associated with the EML over those areas. So we don't see storm development occurring frequently at night, as despite the fact we have this vertical circulation with lift on the moist side of the dry line, the effects of nocturnal increases in convective inhibition mitigate the development of storm formation, despite the fact that we do get baroclinicity associated with this dry line and a related vertical circulation supporting ascent on the moist side of the dry line. However, now let's look at what happens during the daytime. During the daytime, kind of translating over, same idea, we have dry air to the west of the dry line associated with relatively higher density and moist air to the east of the dry line associated with relatively lower density. So the effect of this would be to drive a circulation with ascent over here on the moist side of the dry line and dry, relatively higher density air to the west of the dry line supporting subsidence. But because we get such hot conditions materialized to the west of the dry line with strong downslope flow from the western plateau emanating off the western plateau, temperatures can get quite hot to the west of the dry line, resulting in very low density in some circumstances to the west of the dry line, which mitigates the density difference associated with the moisture contrast across the dry line. Whereas it's relatively just more on the warm side or relatively cooler on the moist side of the dry line than on the hot side of the dry line or the dry side of the dry line, such that density is actually relatively higher. So we have opposing effects over here between temperature and moisture on either side of the dry line, such that the density difference decreases across the dry line. Yet we still end up seeing the dry line as being a source or a zone of favored development of thunderstorms at times. And I'm going to pass this over to Rich right now, who's going to talk about this notion further and how we can look at characteristics of the dryline circulation that can be present through the diurnal heating cycle in the support of thunderstorm development.